Hello friends, I am Ankajan from Skill on Tech. In the series of top 200 pump interview questions, this is a second video which contain question 11 to 20. Question 11. What is characteristics of pump? How you will know the pump operating point? You can see a picture of HQ curve. The characteristics curve of centrifugal pump plot the following parameters against flow rate Q, head H. The head is plotted on Y axis and flow is plotted on X axis. Power input. This is a power input curve, BHP curve. Pump efficiency. This is a pump efficiency curve. And this is a system head curve, which shows the resistance of system against the fluid flow. The characteristics curve shape is primarily determined by the pump type, impeller, pump casing or specific speed. For the normal operating range of centrifugal pump, N, efficiency, flow and head all positive, it is sufficient to plot the characteristics curve in the first quadrant of HQ coordinate system. So let us know where is the operating point of the. You can see in this picture, this is a HQ curve which is going like this, and this is a system head curve, and where these both curves intersect at this point, this is called operating point of the pump. Question 12. What is BEP? How you will operate pump at BEP? BEP is the best efficiency operating point of the pump. We have already understand operating point of the pump, but we must know what is the best efficiency operating point of the pump. Each pump has what is called a best efficiency point, BEP, or sweet spot, a combination of head and flow rate where it delivers its best performance in terms of both energy efficiency and service life. This gives you the best return on your energy cost, but doing so will reduce your maintenance cost as well. Pump run most smoothly and have the longest service life when operated near their best efficiency point. We already know best efficiency point, but where it will come on the HQ curve. So let us try to understand through HQ curve. This is our HQ curve and this is our efficiency curve. So now you can see where system head curve will cut will be operating point, but we should operate the pump where HQ curve intersect with the maximum efficiency point. In this curve, this is the best efficiency point. So we must try to operate the pump in the plus minus 10% plus side or minus 20% in minus side, either side of the pump in this particular range. Otherwise, there are several problems can be faced by the pumps. So you can see here, if your pump is operating out of this is the curve which is shown. If pump will operated inside of this, then it will be a very good operation of the pump. But if it operated beyond this range, so you can see here there is a cavitation, impeller wear, inlet recirculation, outlet recirculation, short bearing and mechanical seal life, all these will face a problem. Here also, outside of this side, you will see this is also a short bearing and mechanical seal life will reduce of the pump. So it is better to operate the pump at best efficiency point to save energy as well as to enhance life of the pump. Your pump is not giving flow. what may be possible reasons. So let us know one by one. Reversed impeller rotation. If your pump is rotating in a reverse direction, it will not give you flow or discharge. Pump suction stationary choked or clogged. Worn impeller wear ring, wear plate. Excessive clearance is in impeller bearing ring, impeller casing ring. So there will be a leakage. Debris in the impeller. If small debris are comes in the impeller, then they will be also disturb the discharge. Closed discharge or suction wall. If your discharge wall is closed or suction wall is closed, then your pump will not give flow. Open bypass wall. If bypass wall is open, then the flow will come back to the suction through a bypass line and you will not get sufficient flow in the discharge pipeline. Loose priming. If your pump is losing priming again and again, air is inside of the casing, pump casing, or in the suction line, then the air is compressed in the pump again and again, it will not give you appropriate flow which is desired by a pump. For that it is designed. Your pump is drawing more power. What are possible reasons? If your pump is drawing more power, means the energy consumption is more and pump is running at very high cost. Gland packing not properly adjusted, means they are more tightened, so they must be appropriately tight. So we must see that there should not be excessive leakage from gland packing, or gland packing should not hot. A specific gravity higher compared to specified liquid which is to be handled. Internal clearance is not set properly in the impeller casing ring. Higher viscosity of pumped liquid. Oversize impeller installed. If your impeller is installed oversized, then pump will also draw more power because Q is proportional to D. Misalignment between pump and driver. If your pump and motor is not properly aligned, then in that case also it will draw more power. Rotating parts in contact with the stationary parts. If your pump rotating parts are rubbing with the stationary parts of the pump, so there will be a friction and your pump motor will draw more power. Worn or damaged bearings. If bearings are damaged, then certainly friction will increase of the rotating components and it will draw more power. Mechanical seal exerts excessive pressure on seat. If your mechanical seal is also not properly installed, it is putting excessive pressure on the seat of stationary seal and rotating seal. That will also be a cause of drawing more power. Bent shaft. If your shaft is bent, this will also be an important reason to draw more power and also produce vibration in the pump. Pump operating too far out on head capacity curve. If your pump is not operating as per best efficiency point, it will also draw more power. So these are some important reasons for drawing more power by a pump prime mover. What is affinity law of pumps? The affinity law expresses the mathematical relationship between the several variables involved in pump performance. So these affinity laws are used to design prototype pumps. They are used to predict what effect speed or impeller diameter changes have on centrifugal pump performance. One can trim an existing impeller and the affinity laws will apply to the new conditions. For change in speed with a geometrically similar family of fixed impeller design, diameter and efficiency, the following conditions and characteristics change simultaneously. So let us see. For constant diameter, Q2 upon Q1 equal to N2 upon N1, H2 upon H1 equal to N2 upon N1 the whole square, P2 upon P1 equal to N2 upon N1 ka whole cube, where N is RPM. For constant speed, Q2 upon Q1 equal to D2 upon D1, H2 upon H1 equal to D2 upon D1 whole square, P2 upon P1 equal to D2 upon D1 whole cube, where D is diameter of pump impeller. So these are important affinity laws of pumps. What is impeller trimming? Why it is done? We already know affinity laws of the pumps. So that will be applied while trimming the impeller. So why it is done? Trimming involves machining the impeller to reduce its diameter. Trimming reduces the impeller tip speed, which in turn reduces the amount of energy imparted to the pump fluid. As a result, the pump flow rate and pressure both decreases. A smaller or trimmed impeller can thus be used efficiently in applications in which the current impeller is producing excessive head. Pump and system curve can provide the efficiency or shaft power for a trimmed impeller. If these curves are not available, affinity law can be used to predict the variation in pumping performance with changes in the impeller diameter. So, as per affinity law, Q2 upon Q1 equal to D2 upon D1. H2 upon H1 equal to D2 upon D1 ka D1 square. P2 upon P1 equal to D2 upon D1 whole cube. Q1 equal to original flow. D1 equal to original impeller diameter, Q2 equal to flow after trimming, and D2 equal to trimmed impeller diameter. Example for trimming of impeller. So let us understand how trimming of impeller result in saving of energy cost. A double suction centrifugal pump equipped with an impeller 14 inches in diameter is throttled to provide a process cooling water flow rate of 3000 GPM, gallon per minute. The pumping system operates for 8000 hours per year with a head of 165 feet and pump efficiency N of 80%. The pump requires 156 bhp. Pump and system curve indicate that a trimmed impeller can supply the 3000 GPM required flow rate at a head of 125 feet. How trimming can be cost saving? So from the affinity laws, the diameter of the trimmed impeller is approximately as follows. HQ Q2 upon H1 Q1 equal to D2 upon D1 whole cube. Holding Q constant, D2 equal to D1 into cube root H2 upon H1 equal to 14 into cube root 125 upon 165 equal to 12.76 inches. Assuming that the pump efficiency remains unchanged, installing a 12 3x4 trimmed impeller reduces input power requirement to the following. P2 equal to H2 into Q2 upon 3960 into efficiency equal to 125 into 3000 upon 3960 into 0.8 equal to 118.4 bhp. Estimated energy saving assuming a 94% motor efficiency are as follows. Bhp 1 minus bhp 2 into 0.746 kilowatt upon hp into 8000 hours per year upon 0.94 equal to 238,720 kilowatt per year. What are metering pumps? A metering pump moves a precise volume of liquid in a specified time period, providing an accurate volumetric flow rate. Delivery of fluids in precise adjustable flow rates is sometimes called metering. The term metering pump is based on the application or use rather than the exact kind of pump used, although a couple type of pumps are far more suitable than most other types of pumps. Many metering pumps are rated to be able to pump into a high discharge pressure. Piston, a plunger and diaphragm pumps are example of metering pump. These are also called dosing pumps, example chlorine dosing, morpholine dosing, etc. in industries. How you will select pump for your application? Explain. Selection of pump depends upon individual application. The important parameters for pump selection are flow, pressure, temperature of your fluid, liquid velocity, specific gravity, vapor pressure, solid present and concentration of debris in the fluid to be handled, liquid properties, allowable leakage from stuffing box and type of prime mover. What are the types of pump classify? This is a very basic question, but we must know. Pumps can be generally classified in two categories: dynamic pressure pumps, positive displacement pumps. And dynamic pressure pumps further classified as a centrifugal, propeller or turbine pumps. In positive displacement pumps, further classify in the two categories: reciprocating pumps, rotary pumps. In reciprocating pumps, pumps include piston or diaphragm pumps. In rotary pumps, gear, lobe, screw, vane, rotary or plunger pumps. So this is a general classification of pumps. What is NPSH available and required? What is difference in both? How you will decide NPSH during installation of pump? NPSH, net positive suction head, is a measure of the pressure experienced by a fluid on the suction eye of a centrifugal pump. This is called NPSH available. NPSHR, NPSH required, is provided by pump manufacturer. A minimum NPSH where cavitation shall not occur to reduce pump efficiency, maximum 3%. It is used to avoid running a pump under condition which favor cavitation. NPSH available shall be always greater than NPSH required and shall kept in mind while carrying out installation of pump, considering temperature conditions of the fluid to be handled. So, this is important that while installation of a pump, we must keep NPSH available more than NPSH required. Otherwise, there are chances of cavitation exist. Thanks for watching the video. If you like this video, hit like button below. Share it with your friends and colleagues. Subscribe our channel for getting updates on upcoming videos. Please leave any comments, feedback to improve the videos. Thank you.